So, good morning, everybody. Today we continue with Enrico Valdinoci. He will today give the third lecture of non-local equations and the different perspectives. So, thank you, Enrico. Thank
you. So, today we will try to finish the... Can you hear me, or...?
Is it on?
Okay. So today we will try to finish our discussion on the eight fundamental differences between the Laplacian and the fractional Laplacian. Actually, let me mention that if you want to go into more advanced subjects, the topic that Xavi introduced yesterday, the one of non-local minimal surfaces, is probably the richest in presenting very important structural difficulties and differences with the classical case. So since Juan Luis doesn't like eight, I just listed seven fundamental differences between classical minimal surfaces and the non-local minimal surfaces. And if we have time, we will look into these differences more. But just to have you, let you taste the flavor of the differences, so I wrote seven. Some of them were mentioned by Xavi yesterday. Uniform perimeter bounds, which are valid for the non-local case and not valid and sometimes not known for the classical case. Stickiness properties at the boundary. The fact that non-local minimal graphs are discontinuous at the boundary. The fact that the non-local catenoid grows linearly instead of logarithmic. The fact that there are unstable non-local minimal cones in one dimension less with respect to the classical case. The fact that the non-local mean curvature flows develops neck pinch type singularities also in the plane. And the fact that non-local phase transitions are more rigid than the classical ones. This is actually probably the topic of Alessio's lectures at the end of the period. So this said, the last difference we were keeping discussing was the decay at infinity. So we discussed the decay at infinity of the heat flow. Which is like 1 over x to the n plus 2s of the fractional heat flow of the fractional Allen-Kahn equation. Which is like in 1D, 1 over x to the 2s. And now what I would like to mention briefly is the decay of ground state solutions for the Schrödinger equation, which is again just polynomial instead of exponential, and the fractional Schrödinger the fundamental solution of the fractional Schrödinger equation like this, and as I was mentioning, for large x, gamma decays like 1 over x to the n plus 2s. Okay? And now some of you were asking me, okay, but why this happens? Well, the first answer is I don't know. But let me try to give you just likely to be wrong, but convincing argument in a sense. So what I think of these decays is that in all of these equations, the right-hand side has to compete and balance with the left-hand side. So the equation, from my psychological point of view, would like to decay as much as possible at infinity, but then looks at the left-hand side and changes his mind. So for instance, here, outside the origin, this is like zero, okay? So in a sense, gamma will try to be as much as decaying as prescribed by the fractional Laplacian. So if you start thinking that gamma is compactly supported or very fast decaying, no matter what, the fractional Laplacian will decay like 1 over x to the n plus 2s. And so it forces the decay to be this one instead of an exponential one, okay? So if you are convinced that this is a good answer, this justifies the decay for Schrödinger. Well, the decay for the heat flow, it's not convincing? Sort of, let's see. Let's see if at least we get, with this argument, the right numbers. I'm not trying to sell this as a proof, but it should give somehow an idea, because for the heat flow, the situation is like the following. So you are solving an equation of this type, and now u times zero the delta. So you may think that at time zero, you are very concentrated at the origin. And then after an infinitesimal time, you develop a little bump. Now you may hope that this little bump converges to zero very fast in x, but then you look at the equation and you see that the increment in time of u at infinity has to grow like 1 over x to the n plus 2s. Because even if your initial distribution, like you think you start from a delta, which is just something like this, then you may hope that after an infinitesimal time, you are very much concentrated, fine. But if this would happen, if this happened, then what you would have is that the time derivative would grow like 1 over x to the n plus 2s. So after another infinitesimal time, you would reach the level 1 over x to the n plus 2s anyway. So the equation pushes up u at infinity exactly for the amount prescribed by the fractional Laplacian. Now, if you are skeptical about my arguments, now you have a very strong point in your favor, because this is 1 over x to the 2s, not 1 over x to the 1 plus 2s, which would be the right decay at infinity. So this tells you that my argument is not really rigorous, but it also tells you that if you fight a bit, you may make it a little bit more convincing, because what is the Allen-Kahn equation? The Allen-Kahn equation is in 1D, so in R, fractional Laplace equal to u minus u cube. So I call v the derivative of u, and I take one derivative of the equation. This gives what? It gives v minus 3 u square v, which is like 1 minus 3 u square v, which at infinity we know that u converges to 1 or minus 1. So this looks like more or less minus 2 v. Now you apply the argument of balancing with the right-hand side 2v, say, for large x, If you apply this argument to V, you may expect that V now decays as much as is prescribed by the fraction of Laplacian. So it decays like 1 over s to the 1 plus 2s, which means that when you integrate back, you have that 1 minus u decays like 1 over x to the 2s. Okay, so this may not be a real proof, so let us now do a real proof of one of the things that I was saying was probably, at least for me, the most surprising difference with respect to the classical case, that is the fact that all functions are locally S-harmonic up to a small error, so that whenever you have, you can prescribe locally any function and approximate it with functions with vanishing fractional Laplacian. So the result is that for any epsilon bigger than zero and for any nice u, there exists some u epsilon such that u epsilon is, say, C2 or CK close to u, and the fractional Laplacian of u vanishes in B1. So somehow you can extend your function u in a suitable way so that the integral oscillations perfectly coincide and the error that you make with your original function is as small as you like. Let me mention that this is a very general result. So at the beginning I thought, okay, it's already strange enough that it works for the fractional Laplacian. And since I come from an elliptic perspective, I thought, well, this has something to do with ellipticity, but actually no. So the same result holds true. Basically, whenever you put here a linear operator which has some non-local coordinates. So you can take your favorite linear operator that has two sets of coordinates, a set that I call the local coordinates, in which the operator is just a differential operator of any order you like and with different orders in different coordinates, and the non-local operator, which is just the sum of fractional Laplacians in different coordinates, possibly of different order. And you can prove the result for this general monster operator. Okay, proving the result for the monster operator in any dimension is a little bit tedious, not because it's hard in itself, but because, of course, you have many variables and many indices, and things are tricky. So just to let you see what's going on after all, I will make a simple proof. In the case I take the operator, just to be more general, not the fractional Laplacian, but an operator L, which corresponds, for instance.
So when you see that there is...
Exactly. So the first lecture we did this picture, maybe I repeat it. So let's see. With color chokes, looks better. So you have your function U, which is defined only in B1. And I drew somehow my worst enemy, a parabola. Like, a parabola doesn't look harmonic for whatever reason. But then you put an epsilon. Of course, I draw nearly infinity norm, but you can do it in smooth norms as well. And then what happens is that you can put a U epsilon here, which is S harmonic, exactly because outside this function has some oscillations, then it goes to zero after a while, but has oscillations that make it S harmonic. Yes, I think that this is kind of a very nice subject of research. And so concerning your type of questions, the proof I will make now, I'm sure you are not going to like it because it's too soft in a sense. It's a proof by contradiction, okay? So the proof doesn't tell me that this is the right picture. Nevertheless, there are some more advanced proofs using Cormander methods by Mika Salo, for instance, in which they can have a better control of the radius in which you have to go to zero or things like this. But somehow, that is not a proof that you can do it in 5 minutes, I think. It's more advanced. This proof is doesn't give you any information on the real picture. Though, as I was saying the last time, this is almost undistinguishable from the real picture because I drew these things like I wish. There is no reason for which this thing is S-harmonic, but then I can repeat the theorem on a larger scale. So I can say, okay, the orange function may be not S-harmonic in B2, but then I repeat the theorem in B2, and so I can complete it outside to a S-harmonic function that looks like this in B2. So somehow it says that really any picture is good on the local case, that the important part always comes from infinity, which is, to me, sounds a bit not natural. Also for large S, this doesn't seem to be right, but it is right, and it is what it is. So just a rough idea, but so the picture that I drew, maybe not the correct picture. So I have here my U, and I drew here just something that looked reasonable to me, but may not look reasonable to you. But what I'm saying is that I can repeat the theorem on a larger scale. So suppose that this is now B2. I can now repeat the theorem with the orange function in B2. And say that, well, the orange function in B2 maybe is not the right thing that makes U as harmonic in B1, but I can repeat the theorem in B2 and say, okay, there is a function that is almost indistinguishable from the orange function, which makes the orange function as harmonic in B2 and also in B1. So the picture I drew is essentially correct because I can change the data closer and closer to infinity and make any picture correct. So there is no way to distinguish just from looking at the picture whether or not the function is S-harmonic because this is an information that dramatically comes from the data at infinity. Okay? Okay, so So my suggestion is to prove this result not for the easiest case of the fractional Laplacian, but not for the hardest case of a monster operator. So something in between, my suggestion is to look at what happens for the heat kernel, the fractional heat kernel. Good. So if we do that, so in a sense, I'm going to prove that all functions are locally S-caloric up to a small error. S-caloric in the sense that it is a kernel of the fractional heat equation. And so my function, first of all, some reductions are the following. First, I can assume that U is a polynomial. And the reason is somehow the Stone-Weierstrass theorem. Well, there's a small refinement of Stone-Weierstrass. Usually in Italy they taught us Stone-Weierstrass in one variable and win approximation in L infinity. But if one looks at the approximation with Gaussians, basically the Stone-Weierstrass holds in any dimension and for any CK norm. So what I'm saying is that any C2 function U can be approximated by a polynomial. So I first approximate U with the polynomial and then the polynomial with U epsilon, and so I can reduce to the case of the polynomial. Then in fact, as the problem is linear, I can reduce to the case in which U is a monomial. You know what a monomial is, so just, let me write it. So U of XT, say U of big X. Big X is comprising both a variable X and T, is of the form X to the M, okay, with the multi-index notation. And the reason for this is that the problem is linear. So if I approximate any monomial, then I sum them up and I approximate a polynomial. Then the third observation is that what is important to do is to produce the right derivatives at zero. So the goal would be to find a function, say V, such that the derivatives at zero are prescribed, say, up to order m. So the alpha V of zero are prescribed this is a bad notation because m here is a multi-index, so you have to put the modulus also, the norm of the multi-index. Here, when I have a multi-index, the modulus for me is just the sum of the entries. And so let me call this j, just not to carry the multi-index notation over and over. So why is this so? Well, because then you can just blow up your picture, because if this is true, you can take VR of X to be R to the J V of X over R. Now, if the derivative, for instance, suppose that in this way V is of the form V of X is of the form XM plus order of XJ plus 1. So here you are fixing all the derivatives of V in the origin to be the ones I like, to be the derivatives of U. The derivatives of U are 0, 0, 0, 0, up to the last derivative, which is whatever is prescribed here. Okay? So I say, well, also V has the same derivatives near 0 up to the correct order. This means that when I do this rescaling, Here I get exactly x to the m, because the j is exactly the norm of m, plus order of r. So basically, when I do the difference between vr and u, I get something small, and so I prove the theorem. Okay? So the real issue is just to understand what happens near the origin. Now, this seems a great simplification, but if you think in the classical case, it's exactly what you cannot do, because, for instance, if you say that your Laplacian is zero, it means that the second derivatives of your function have to lie in a codimension one space, because, for instance, in dimension two, the second derivative in the first direction have to balance the second derivative in the second direction. So it's not that you can produce any number you want. The sum of the two have to be zero, okay? So this is somehow the core of the proof, and it's the part in which the non-local structure is richer than the local one. And so I now prove three. And as I was mentioning, the proof is by contradiction. So I look at a space V, which contains all the functions H, say from R to R, such that L of H is equal to zero in a neighborhood of the origin. Okay. Well, this is a non-empty space because the zero function is there. And then I can call V0 in V0 I do this. I take all the functions here and I compute their derivatives up to the right order. So this collects an array called it H. So for any function here, I compute all the derivatives up to the right order, and I list the derivatives in this array. So this is a finite dimensional array, and say this is contained in an Euclidean space, and I call n plus 1 the dimension. Okay? Well, n plus 1 is just the number of alphas for which alpha less than j holds. And now my claim is that V0 is not only contained in this space, but it's actually equal to this space. So it has really maximal span. And you see, if I prove this, then I'm done, because I have found a function which is escaloric near the origin. Sorry, I forgot to write it. There exists a V such that L of V is zero, a solution of the problem such that. So, if this is true, in particular, I take the array of the derivatives of U, and I get this array through functions that are escaloric. How I prove this? Well, the proof is by contradiction. Well, if not, it means that this V0, which is a linear space because the sum of S-caloric function is S-caloric, this V0 is actually a strictly linear subspace of R to the n plus 1. So a picture would be like this. The blackboard is R to the n plus 1, and V0 has to be here, or to be a linear subspace of this plane, for instance. So I call mu this direction, and I say that the contradiction of the fact that V0 spans everything is that V0 is contained in the space, I don't know how to call it, maybe Y in Rn plus 1, such that nu dot y is equal to 0. Okay? Good. Now what do I do? The idea is that I choose one H for which I find a contradiction by taking the solution of the somehow of the decoupled eigenvalue problem. So what I do is I look for a function phi, which is the first eigenfunction of the fractional Laplacian in minus 1, 1. Oh, I didn't say, but I'm just doing the one-dimensional case. So one-dimensional space variable and one-dimensional time variable. Well, and to make things much simpler, let me actually do the case of the one-half fractional Laplacian. The computation would be the same with S, but the exponents will be more annoying. So let me take S equal to 1 half. Otherwise, one has to adjust exponents and things are less transparent. But if you take, for instance, 1 half, with Dirichlet datum, that is, I'm solving equal to lambda phi in minus 1, 1, and phi equal to 0 outside. Now, the important thing is that we know more or less how this function looks like. This is something that we discussed in the first lecture. We know that the boundary behavior of this function is not Lipschitz up to the boundary, is only Hölder, like a circumference. And we computed, if you remember, what happens for the square Laplacian of 1 minus x squared under the square root. And that's exactly the same behavior. So basically, if I take a small delta, what happens is that phi of minus 1 plus delta goes like delta to the power 1 half. Okay? Basically, phi looks like this near minus 1. And if you want, in a distributional sense, you can take the derivative of this expression, and you can actually prove that, delta positive. So on this side, it grows like delta to the 1 half. And if I take k derivative of this guy, it goes like 1 half minus k. Okay, then if this is the case, I think I take h of x and t to be e to the minus tau t phi of minus 1 plus tau over lambda x. I apologize with the Greeks. I know that my lambda is wrong. My lambda should be this one, okay? But I think you understand my writing. Okay? So I have to check that H belongs to V, because later on I want to use H to find the contradiction. So let's check that H belongs to V. Well, for this, I have to apply L to H. So this guy is, if I take the time derivative, it's easy because I have the exponential. So it's just minus tau. And then I have e to the minus tau tau. Ah, tau is fixed for me. Eh? Fixed tau, I take derivatives in t, I have minus tau, and then h. This is the time derivative. And then I have to do the Laplacian to the 1/2 of the phi. Well, if I do that, I get what? I get plus e to the minus tau t. And then by scaling, the Laplacian to the 1/2 is an operator of order 1. Because the Laplacian is operator of order 2, the 1/2 is 2 times 1/2 makes it 1. Okay? So I have to take the fractional Laplacian of all this function, which is the fractional Laplacian of this function, evaluated at this point, but I have to take into account the scale factor. And this is the only reason for which I took 1/2 here. If you do the proof with the different s, you have more annoying exponent, and so that's why I did that. Okay? Now, I remember who phi is. Phi is an eigenfunction, so instead of square root of the Laplacian of phi, I can just write lambda phi. So if you agree, I erase the fractional Laplacian and I put the lambda. But now I, how you say in Spanish, jack. And this is zero. This is zero because it's tau, and then whatever else is remaining is h, if I'm not mistaken with the signs. Okay? Fine. Now, once you have that, you can now use your h in your contradictory assumption written here. So since h belongs to H, it means that when I compute the derivatives in zero, they have to lie in this hyperplane. So what I have is that since H is in V, the derivative are in V0, and V0 is in that hyperplane, which means that if I compute all the derivatives of H and evaluate them at zero, I get zero. So here I'm using the notation for which nu is a unit vector, so is in Sn, and I write nu as nu alpha. So somehow I'm writing the coordinates of nu with the same convention of the derivative of H. Okay. And then I compute what is the alpha derivative. Now, unfortunately, I have to introduce a new convention. I have to distinguish between time and space derivative. So my multi-index alpha will be thought as an alpha x, alpha t. So these are the x derivatives and these are the t derivatives. So nu alpha is some nu alpha t, alpha x alpha t, if you want. And if you prefer, the norm of alpha is just alpha x plus alpha t. So this I just wrote, this in coordinates, then I have to take derivatives. If I take alpha t derivatives of the exponential, I get minus tau to the power alpha t. Then I have to write the exponential, but I will have to take t equals zero after. So the exponential of minus tau t at t equals zero will get one. Then I have to take alpha x derivatives of phi and evaluate them as zero. When I take alpha x derivative, I get tau over lambda to the power alpha x. Then I have alpha x derivative of phi. Made a mistake. So let me introduce also an additional parameter, delta. Well, the same computation would have worked before. Before it was just, I mean, the translation here doesn't play any role. But now I want to leave this delta because I want to have here one minus one plus delta, okay? If I don't put the delta here, I go into a little trouble because phi is not differentiable at zero, so I want that zero is well inside my domain. So that's why I put the delta here. That's the only reason. And then I get this. And now I use what I know on the derivatives of phi. So I can write this guy as the sum of alpha x plus alpha t less than j, nu of alpha x alpha t, then I have minus one to the alpha t, so to the alpha t plus alpha x over lambda to the alpha x. And then this is delta to the one half minus alpha x, one plus little o of one. Well, little o of one is something that goes to zero when delta goes to zero. So here I'm just using the decay of the function phi. Okay? And so I know that this thing is equal to zero. Now, what I do now is that I take alpha x as large as possible. So this new alpha, well, can be zero for some coordinates, but it's not possible that all the coordinates are zero because new is on the sphere. So sooner or later, maybe the bigger coordinates are zero, but when I reduce, I find the coordinate which is non-zero. So just for simplicity, I take alpha bar x to be the first coordinate in x for which there exists a t coordinate for which this is not zero. Okay? Otherwise, it means that they are all zero. So I take the largest alpha x for which there exists an alpha t in the right range with alpha t plus alpha x less than j and mu of alpha x alpha t less than zero. So if I write this, this sum here actually spans with the condition that alpha x is less than alpha bar x, because whatever happens above the alpha bar gives that nu is zero, so you are just summing zero contribution, okay? So this reduces maybe the sum, or maybe it doesn't reduce it because the bigger alpha x is already giving a non-zero nu. In that case, you don't reduce it, but in case the bigger alpha x is giving a non-zero, a zero nu, then you reduce it to alpha bar. Okay, so you have that zero is equal to this guy. Now what I do is I multiply this expression by delta to the alpha bar. Alpha bar x. This is a positive number, so I just have alpha bar x here. Now I send delta to zero. And what I get here, well, I get here, I multiply by delta to the alpha bar x minus 1/2. The minus 1/2 is useful because I remove this 1/2 here. Now I send delta to zero. So when I do this, I have a delta going to zero here. So whenever alpha x is less than alpha bar, this exponent will be positive and it will give zero. Okay? So if I send delta to zero, the only exponent which is remaining is the case in which alpha x is equal to alpha bar of x, okay? So let me write it like this. Here in principle I have alpha of x less than alpha bar of x, but if I'm strictly less, I get zero. So by sending delta to zero, here I get alpha x equal to alpha bar of x. Okay. So this is somehow alpha bar, this is alpha bar, this is alpha bar. Now, alpha bar minus alpha bar gives zero. So this gives one. And when I send delta to zero, one plus little o is equal to one. Okay. Now I have that this expression is equal to zero. Then let me multiply by lambda to the alpha bar x and divide by tau to the alpha bar x. Well, if I do this, this and this are zero. Well, but this means that you have reduced your problem by the alpha bar, because now you have a polynomial in the variable tau, which is equal to zero. So by the identity principle of the polynomial, the coefficient has to be zero. But the coefficient is not zero for the way you choose alpha bar. So this is a contradiction, tells you that you cannot be contained in a linear space of Rn plus 1. And so somehow it proves the theorem. And it gives you that all functions are locally escaloric up to a small error. And the general structure for the general operator is somehow the same. Just one has to be a little bit more careful with this choice of indices in order to reduce step by step by one what happens when I send delta to zero in the multidimensional case. But somehow the structure would be more or less the same. In the next 5 minutes, let just me recall that in the next lectures, I would like to address a bit the regularity theory of non-local minimal surfaces. So this is a topic that already Xavi has introduced and mentioned, so I will be very happy to take advantage of the material that is has already introduced. And so one result that I would like to present in some detail is the analog of Bernstein theorem for non-local minimal surfaces. So Bernstein theorem in the classical case says that if you have a minimal surface which is a graph, so say a minimal graph, and the dimension of your ambient space is 8 or less, then your non-local minimal graph has to be a plane. So the classical Bernstein theorem says that if you is a solution of the minimal surface equation, so it has it creates a graph which has zero mean curvature. N is less than I always make it wrong 7, right? Because I am in dimension 8 in the ambient space. Then U is an affine function. And in the classical case, the dimension 7 is optimal, because if n is equal to 8, Bombieri, De Giorgi, and Giusti constructed an example. So this would be R8, and this would be Simon's cone in R8. So think that what I drew here is that R8 has two coordinates, x and y, in R4 times R4. What I drew here is the norm of x equal to the norm of y, whatever it means in R8. And so basically they constructed a saddle shape function in R9, so you have one coordinate more, which is, say, positive here, negative here, and which goes cubically to plus and minus infinity. So this is a zero-level set for the thing, and this is growing here, something like this, and going to minus infinity on the other side. So we will discuss somehow the analog of this problem in the fractional setting. Let me say that the problem is still very open in the sense that there are some results in this direction, but we do not know whether the results we obtain are optimal, and we do not have any counterexample like this. So the fractional case is still, the complete picture is still very open, but I will try at least to introduce some material that can be useful to see what's going on in this field. And maybe my time is over.